Los Angeles and Boston and elsewhere. What tools do you need in order to carry out that broken window approach and lead the parenting calls to the hospitals?
Well, you need a couple of things. First of all, you need beat integrity. You need accountability. You need the same cops on the same beats every day so they are accountable for fixing the conditions that you're all complaining about. And I've probably been to a couple of thousand community meetings in my 30-year now. That's scary to say. 30-year police career. And I rarely hear complaints about crime. It doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. But what we receive are quality of life complaints. We receive calls, we receive complaints in meetings about excessive noise. We receive complaints about bars or taverns or clubs that are problematic and hurting the community. These are the complaints that we receive. So those aren't calls for service. In my mind, those are things that cops should be doing proactively if they're assigned to the same places every single day. So that's the first thing you need, is beat integrity. The second thing you need is less calls for service. Because if the officers are just running around chasing a radio, if they don't do anything except show up for work and go where that communications device takes them, they're not doing police work. They're not doing police work. And that's no way to run a police department in this time. So we have to take some of those calls for service out of the system, which are policy decisions that I will make, and there's going to be some haggling and rancor over that, I'm sure. But if those cops aren't chasing that radio and dealing with the remote control job, they can shut down the noise problem on a corner because they're not busy driving by. So we need those two things right there. And the third thing is obviously a commitment to broken windows, which is what we have, trust me.
What is the plan for the Wrigley Field Detail Unit after consolidation? Will it be overseen by the local commander now? That all of the Wrigley area will be in one district? And in regards to the Lincoln Avenue stretch between Fullerton and Mercy, is it possible to add foot patrols there on Friday and Saturday evenings, as we have these populous and popular?
Okay, so I was going to turn to you, Alderman, and say the Wrigley Field Detail. So I'm actually going to split that question because the Alderman and I had this conversation in my office about the way that detail works, and I was not satisfied when I looked into it. So we're going to redesign that. It definitely is something that I believe is something that's necessary. As far as the other, by the way, the point is it's staying. Let's put it that way. I think that's a greater concern. My goal is to figure out the best way to make it work. And I think the biggest issue was we didn't have the same person in charge for a long time. So I'm a big believer in you own it, you fix it, you get it done. And that's where we're going to go. But as far as the other issues go, the commanders will be accountable for making sure that those conditions are met. One of the things that you're going to keep hearing is pushed out of authority and accountability. It's the commander's job to handle the local conditions. It's my job to handle the policy decisions and figuring out how to divvy up the resources and getting them out there. So when it comes to those local conditions, the commanders are accountable for making that happen. I'm not going to tell them to put a foot post here. I'm just not going to do it. I'm going to ask them why there isn't a foot post there, if there's a reason that I believe a foot post should be there. So that's the way that we do business now. Put it in their hands and hold them accountable for it. So I'm sorry, I'm not avoiding the question. I'm just telling them the policy.
I know you're not
the avoiding type. No. To follow up on a question from our friends and right-wing neighbors, Lincoln Avenue, Friday and Saturday nights, crowded with bars, popular like Wrigleyville is now. Is it possible to put foot patrols down there in order to help maintain order?
It's the same answer. That's a local condition that I'm not going to direct the commander on how to address it. I'm going to ask them what it is they're doing about that problem.
Okay. Reminder, any additional questions and prompts, please bring them up. We'll be happy to answer them. We have here a question in regards to the 13th district. It is, quote, unquote, a known gain and neutral area. When the 13th district is closed, isn't there a risk of a gang turf battle? What does the police department intend to do to protect the community?
Well, I guess that's pretty much the same answer that we've already given. When we look at the consolidation, when we look at the consolidation between 12 and 13, it's really the same dynamic that I explained, which is you have two lower band districts as far as geography, population, calls for service, and crime. And when you combine them, they become a mid-level district, and they rank number one as far as total number of police officers assigned of the 22 districts that will be consolidated. So again, it's up to me to set up the system, and it's up to the district commander to address the conditions that exist there. So if there is a gang problem in a district, through the CONSTAT process, commander explains to us what's going on, while at the same time, we bring in detectives, narcotics, and the gang unit to focus all those resources on what the problem is in that particular district. So that's the system. As far as the specific answer, that's up to the commander.
We have a question in regards to detail. What will you use to determine the surplus police personnel? Move them to other districts after an initial merge?
Okay. We're not doing it.
As the statistics change over next year, is there the opportunity that the city will address the 900 to 1,000 estimated officers that it is short to those higher crime districts?
I thought we already dealt with the being short issue. Honestly, I mean, I'm not being facetious. I'm really, really not. If you look at Los Angeles, we have way more officers per capita. If you look at New York City, I think we actually have more officers per capita than New York City. We're actually very, very close. So as crime comes down, which it has been doing for years now, across the country, the question becomes, do we actually need that many cops? And I don't know the answer to that. I can't predict the future. What I can tell you is these methods that I'm talking about are tried and true. They actually work. So we've already kind of crossed our T's and dotted our I's on the redeployment issue. The right now, the 7th district in Englewood, that everybody is aware of, is a very high crime neighborhood. Right now, they have the most police officers in the city. As far as police officers per capita, after the consolidation, they're still right up near the top of the list. So we're able to achieve both ends right now, which, listen, I've read about this. Over the years, I know it's been an enormous issue in the city of Chicago. And I think that what we're finding here is a solution that crosses all of those barriers and kind of puts that argument and that fight to bed.
In regards to falling crime statistics, it says that burglaries are up citywide less than 1%. However, in the 19th district, it's up nearly 14.5%. Similarly, motor vehicle thefts up 9% citywide, but it's up 16.3% in the 19th district. What information have you been receiving from your commanders in regards to how they're addressing those issues?
Again, each individual crime has different methodologies that we When it comes to issues of burglary, I actually authored the burglary and property crime reduction strategy that we use in New York City, which really kind of sort of is one of the leaders in the field. There's a number of things that we can do as far as burglary is concerned. We've given this strategy to our commanders. We're implementing it here. Burglary is a serial crime, right? A person who does burglaries doesn't do one and say, oh, I'm good, I'm done. No, they do it time and time again. So you focus on the people who have the highest propensity to do it. You deploy your officers when you identify those patterns. And you go to the places where they bring the property. You go to the fencing locations, and you make arrests at those locations also. So there's a myriad of things that we can do there. As far as stolen vehicles go, where does the car end up, and how does it get there, right? So the whole issue of both of those property crimes does not fall off the radar, because crime conditions are different from different parts of the city. We're certainly aware of that. And we have strategies to address each individual crime that we come across. And we're implementing the systems and the methods to make that happen.
Two social questions here. One is, with the consolidation of the districts, what will happen in terms of the frequency and number of CAPS meetings throughout the community and the number of CAPS representatives?
The CAPS systems is something that I like the concept, and I like some of the structure of it, and I think we could do it better. CAPS responsibility, in my estimation, should really be in the district commander's hands. When I was in New York City, I was a lieutenant when Lee Brown came to New York, and he implemented a strategy of community policing, which I always like to point out that if you ask 100 people what does community policing mean, you're going to get 99 different answers. And that's only because one couple is married. And she's probably telling them what to say. But anyway, the point is, when Lee Brown came to New York City and implemented the method of community policing of the day, it was really putting a police officer, a 22 or 24-year-old police officer, with very limited life experience, let alone police officer experience, calling them a problem solver, and putting them out in the community with no resources. And it was really an administrative exercise to identify problems. You had to keep these beatings that were about this fat. And it was a wholesale failure. Now, I think a good method of community policing is to find the place where the rubber meets the road. And in my estimation, it's the district commander. The district commander has the resources, has the experience, has the ability to pull other city agencies to the table to help us address various problems that we deal with. What I see in CAPS is a program, not a philosophy. I don't know if that makes sense. Some of that structure, I think, is very good for communication, and I want to hang on to that. And I want to figure out how to fold that into my theories on community policing and how we get things done. As far as the numbers of folks doing it and the frequency of the beat meetings, I really can't speak to. I haven't gotten there. And again, I'm not one to avoid a question, but I haven't gotten there. We still have to work out some nuts and bolts on how we're going to do that.
What is your commitment to maintaining and improving the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender diversity in the department, and specifically the LGBT liaison in 23? Will that post be retained?
I have no intention of not maintaining that post. That's the police officer, what's his name? I met him, Jose Rios. Yeah, he's spoken very highly across the board. We have to be sensitive as far as diversity goes in 1,000 different ways. We have to be racially sensitive. We have to be sensitive as far as religion is concerned. And we have an intolerance for violations regarding any sort of race, gender, orientation, or religion, or any of those topics. So we're going to reinforce that within the department, and we're going to ensure that we show sensitivity in all aspects. And you know, I'm just going to probably make a mistake in grade a little bit. Before I came in here, I was stopped by a reporter outside, and if you've been paying attention to the papers, the Occupy Chicago movement has been handled totally different than probably any place else in the country. And that's a credit to the men and women of this department who are showing them the sensitivity rather than the hard cop, get the heck out of here, right? So we're seeing an entire different methodology used here in Chicago. Every single person is being addressed and told you have the opportunity to leave. If you don't leave, you will be arrested. And they say, no, I'm going to be arrested. Okay, stand up, zip cuffs, and you go off. We're not treating it in one big fashion. We're not saying you 200 people, if you don't leave, you are subject to arrest. We're addressing individual people. This is a shift in policing philosophy. And the results are, look at what happened in New York. Look at what happened in Oakland. Look at what's happened across the country. And look at, knock on wood, what hasn't happened here in Chicago. And the reason is because of our sensitivity to what's going on. And it plays right into everything that we do, and especially in regards to those groups that you mentioned.
Next question is in regards to the building at the 19th District, in that the circuit court will be staying open at Belmont and Western, and the lockup must remain, and detective headquarters remain open. Yeah, open and active. Will the cost of the lockup shift to the county, and will the savings of closing the 19th District actually be substantial?
Yes, the savings will still be substantial. We're still operating other facilities, obviously, in the Chicago Police Department. The cost really is minimal as far as maintaining the actual building. Don't think that that's where the cost savings is. The cost savings comes from not managing it with the resources that we need to manage it. So by consolidating that into just a couple of different things, there's minimal cost savings in walking out of the building. The cost savings is actually in the management.
And the cost of the lockup of that shift to county?
No, we're going to continue to do exactly what we're doing.
Alderman Blackspack, you'll be impressed to know that one of your constituents is concerned about your political well-being. Why are two of the three proposed police station closings in Alderman Wagspack's ward? Is it because he was one of the few who opposed the mayor's O'Hara concessions to Westfield? There have been two shootings in my immediate Roscoe Village neighborhood since July. What's going to be done to remain vigilant in that area? I think you've answered that question.
I think I've answered that too. First part of that question, I'm going to stay with
it. If savings and economy is a motivating issue, why hasn't the old Shakespeare District building on Foster been sold? It's been shuttered for more than a decade.
Okay, I can't speak to that. I don't even know about that building. But what I can tell you is what I said earlier, which is this is not necessarily about cost. It happens to be a residual benefit, and that would save money by doing this.
Some officers say that equipment is not state-of-the-art in the cars, that many times they have to go to the headquarters to connect to mainframes or to file a report. What improvements are planned and for when so that officers will remain fully functional in their beat?
Technology plays a huge role in modern policing. We are in the process of creating something called the Police Foundation, which is a business, it's a public-private partnership to raise funds to provide resources that are not line items in our budget. And just the best way to think of it is the first police foundation was created in 1973 in New York City to buy bulletproof vests for policemen. So just an example. Technology really falls into that area. Laptop computers in the cars and things of that nature. Now this is where we're getting squeezed financially. We don't have the money to invest in that, even though there's long-term cost savings. So what we're doing is we're finding alternative methods to make that funding appear, which is through the creation of this police foundation. And there's plenty and plenty of corporations who want to get involved in that and help us out. So that's going to be a big success for us.
Coming back to the physical plant, does the new 23rd District station have the capacity to hold all of the officers, including parking, the combined districts?
I'm going to let Brian talk. Even though I didn't order him, I'm going to make him get up here and explain something.
Yeah, we're looking at that now. There was it's obviously a brand new facility. Again, that helps with the technology as well because it's got all the fiber connections in the backbone with the new facility as well. Parking, we're going over a parking plan now, trying to identify parking for the police vehicles as well as the officers' vehicles when they show up for work. But we do believe that there'll be enough parking because not all the officers are going to be on one watch. They'll be spread out on different watches throughout the 24-hour period.
Well, all I can say from personal experience is if you put in special permit parking, make sure the officers get those permits up because those are expensive tickets. Superintendent McCarthy, according to statements that you made during the meeting in the 13th District, you said that there'll be more one-person squad cars in order to respond to more calls.
I said no such thing. I'm not an advocate of one-man cars at all.
I wasn't there. I can't speak to
the authority. I was.
the flip side, or the last half of that question was, however, the statement was made in that meeting that officers will not get out of that car. Can you please balance the statement? If you didn't make it.
I'm not an advocate of one-man cars. As a matter of fact, if I recall correctly, somebody raised a question about, isn't it true that more officers get hurt in one-man cars? And the fact is, no, they don't. Nationwide, there's a study that shows that officers don't get hurt as frequently in one-man cars because they don't engage crowds. One cop is probably not likely to get out and engage a crowd of 20 people on a corner. So I, first of all, do not advocate for one-man cars, but there was something referencing something about cops getting hurt in one-man cars, and I don't go for it anyway, so it's irrelevant.
Thanks for clarifying that. What will happen to the 19th District Burglary Task Force post-consolidation?
Again, I'm not going to tell the commander what they need to do. They're going to be held accountable for what happens there. So that's a local issue that the commander will have to address.
Both you and First Deputy Weisinger have said that closing stations will increase efficiency. With the transporting of detainees between the lockups, will this increase the amount of time officers are spent off the streets?
There's a possibility. I mean, the logic would have it that that's a possibility, but I don't believe so because, A, it's going to be a very short time if it does, in fact, somehow address it. But, B, we ensured that when we looked at the plan for closing lockups, we ensured that the furthest lockup away was within 5 miles, if I recall correctly.
This will have to be within the consolidated district.
Yes.
We're staying within the district, and we just changed our order.
So
the current lockup in 23 is already sending their females. They were already sending their females to the 19th district lockup. They are now sending their males to the 19th district lockup. That's an area lockup that allows for both male and female prisoners. The 23rd district did that. So we're going to maintain the 19th district lockup at Belmont and Western. We're going to utilize our personnel to keep that one going. It is a court. We mentioned it earlier. The other thing is we just changed our general order that allows a supervisor can allow their officers to process their arrestees at Belmont and Western as well. So if they make an arrest that's close to Belmont and Western, since the lockup's right there, the supervisor can make a decision to allow them to process that arrestee in 19 and put them into lockup there.
What are your expectations regarding the urgency, content, and method of communication between the PD and district residents about issues of public safety? Specifically, what's the role of the ward office in your communication strategy, the role of online community resources such as EveryBlock, and how will you continue to hold the new district accountable? And lastly, how should residents express their concern that they feel they're not getting the information or responses they're looking for?
That's like an essay question. We're going to take a swing at it.
25 words.
A lot of parts to that. We're actually constructing a complete communication strategy. One of our greatest challenges is communication, not only with the public, but certainly even within the department, because, you know, I sit around and we have our meeting. I don't sit around. I sit in meetings and I give my upper echelon marching orders, and then I go out and I speak to policemen on the street, and I find out that message never reaches them. And it's very troubling to me. So we have an opportunity now to figure out how to make that work better, not only within and without, but without. Through things like social media, the rumor mill, blogs, social media, really are taking over driving messages, and that's troubling, because many times the information is not true. So we're developing an entire communication strategy, both inside and outside the department. As far as how do you communicate an issue to a local commander, the commanders are accountable for ensuring that those lines of communication are open. And that's the beauty of having a paramilitary organization. Because while I'm not going to do the commander's job, I don't expect anybody else to do my job. But by the same token, when they're not performing, then Deputy Chief Tobias is accountable for ensuring that your needs are being met. So it's kind of like when you go to a restaurant and you're not getting good service, so you tell the waiter, I want to see the manager. And then if you don't get what you need from the manager, then you go to the owner. And really, that's the same methodology in the police department. At the end of the day, I'm accountable for everybody's behavior, and I accept it. But I push back down hard on that. So I don't want to have to do the commander's job.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have asked all the written questions that we've received. I don't know if anyone here feels that they have a question that has not been answered. If you do, please raise your hand.